Welcome to our service this morning. It's a special day today. It's the first Sunday in Advent, and it's that season again. So whether you're here present with us in church today, or whether you're watching on Zoom, see the camera's up there, or whether you'll be watching on YouTube later in the week, it's lovely to have you here. And we hope that you'll sense God's presence as we worship together. As you see, there are four candles. No jokes, Jack. No. I know Neil's smiling there, but four candles, white ones, and a red one. The first candle is one which is symbolic of hope. And the next three are peace, love, and joy. You'll hear more about that later. Hope. We all need a little bit of hope in our lives, something to look forward to, something to lift us from the depression and misery sometimes of the day, whether it's the weather or whether it's cost of living or whatever. We need that little bit of hope. And we find hope talked about quite a bit in the book of Isaiah. Now, Isaiah was a prophet, as you all know, and he lived about 700 years ago. And part of his mission from God was to point out Judah's rebellion and to point out that they had to be punished for this. So Isaiah was calling the nation back to God and telling of God's salvation through Jesus, and also offering a promise of comfort, deliverance, and restoration. Normally, you would punish a person, and that would be the end of it, but not God. He has another side to him, a side which is compassionate, forgiving, and merciful. And this is what he says through his prophet Isaiah, that although these things, Judah and Israel, will mean exile, will mean deportation, will mean death and suffering, I've got plans for this nation. They're very special to me. And as you read through the book of Isaiah, and I would encourage you to do that, and when you do it, take a pencil and a ruler and just underline the verses on that. Use it as a workbook. And when you go back to that, read that chapter or read that book, these verses will jump back at you and you will get that same warm feeling about them as when you first read them. Some of the verses, I'm going to read them to you, that you might find jumping out at you, is that the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. Now, if that's not hope and a future prophecy, I don't know. He also, a little further down, writes, "For a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders. These will be his royal titles: Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace." One that I rather appreciate and love is the one that says, "God will keep in perfect peace all who trust in him." And an even more personal one, this is that God will strengthen those with tired hands. Who hasn't got tired hands? Or encourage those who have weak knees to be strong and do not be afraid, for your God is coming to destroy your enemies. And one very well-known one in Isaiah is the comfort my people. Tell Jerusalem her sad days are gone and her sins are pardoned. Your God is coming in all his glorious power. One I want to dwell on this morning is also in Isaiah, chapter 12. Praise the Lord. He was angry with me, and now he comforts me. See, God has come to save me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. The Lord God is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. With joy, you will drink deeply from the fountain of salvation. And in that wonderful day, you will sing, thank the Lord, praise his name, tell the world what he has done. Oh, how mighty he is. Sing to the Lord, for he has done wonderful things. Make known his praise around the world. Let all the people of Jerusalem shout his praise with joy, for great is the Holy One of Israel who lives among you. Heavenly Father, as we come here this morning as your people to worship and praise you, we ask that you give us your Holy Spirit to do that. Father, cleanse our lives. Take from us the stresses and strains, and help us to focus on our God and Savior through our Lord Jesus Christ. So be with us this morning. Accept our praises and our thanks through Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Let's stand and give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. Let's sing our praises to him, our living hope, for he is good, he is above all things, and his love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand, an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Setting sun, his love endures forever, and by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
Forever God is
Thank you for your presence here with us today. May we know you as our God, our King. May we know you as the Holy One. May our worship to you today be acceptable. Father God, we thank you for your Son. As we think in this Advent time of his coming, your provision for us, our living hope, we thank you that through him we can come into your presence and see your glory. Father God, touch us today. Meet us today, Lord. May we leave this place changed through your presence and through your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
I said that today's preacher is Steve Aiken. And I'm going to ask Steve to come up here and have a little chat. Ewan is away at a family event somewhere this weekend, so we hope he'll be listening in into our service at some stage. It's probably about 3-4 years ago at this time, I recall that you came and preached in our church, because two coat hangers for me. One, it was the first Sunday in Advent, and the other, it was Thanksgiving weekend. Tell me a little bit about what's been happening in your life since you were last here 3-4 years ago, when I think you were actually helping the Kelso Church.
Yeah.
Are you okay with your mic there?
Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah.
Well, it's good to see all you lovely folk again. And, I'm based at Selkirk Baptist, where my family are, but I preach out at different places. And I was asked to help Kelso Baptist because they were down to just a handful of people. And so I went there for about 2.5 years just to encourage them and begin to build them up and get them ready so that they can call a minister. So over that time, they were built up. We began reaching out, and then they were able to call Rob Jones, who is there now, and the church is beginning to grow again. So other than that, I've just been, I go most Sundays, I preach in different churches, Church of Scotland and Baptist, so I guess that keeps me off the streets.
That work at Kelso has taken off quite a bit, and we've got to give thanks to God for growing churches. The other question is that you don't have a Souter accent. You know what Souters are, don't you? Selkirk people. You don't have a Selkirk accent, so they'll be wondering where you've come from.
Well, those that know me, I come from the western part of America, Oregon from above California. But I grew up in a non-Christian family, but my earliest memory is from just childhood, I always have believed in God. And whenever anybody would take me to church, we lived out in the country, and so a retired school teacher and her husband took me to church, where I became a Christian as a little boy. And one of the things that I appreciated then and still do is they had an altar. And when somebody wanted to respond to the Lord, they didn't just raise their hand and say a little prayer and everybody had their heads down, but you had to go forward, kneel at the altar, confess your sins, and confess Christ. And I still remember that as just a little boy doing that. But at a young age, I felt called to be a missionary. And then my church sent us, 9 of us out in the summer of 76 to come and work with Youth of the Mission in Hoyk, and fell in love with Scotland, came back on my own the next summer, and then my church sent me out at the just after Christmas time, 1979, and except for visits home, this is Scotland's been home. But I haven't been able to get rid of my accent, so sorry.
Anyhow, it gives you an opportunity to see who you'll be preaching to, and hopefully they'll all stay awake when it comes to that time. Anyway, thanks, Steve. We'll hear more from you. And now Alistair is going to come up and do the intercessory prayer for us this morning. Alistair. And then after that, we'll have a song, and then Gavin will come up and do the reading after that.
It's a lovely privilege, really, to be asked to lead a prayer together in church. And it's a great encouragement to me, one of the dinosaurs of the congregation, to be able to assist in some small way. Already, we've felt a sense of God's presence, because surely, where two or three, and many more here today, gather in his name, he's there in our midst. So let's pray. At this time of Advent, we praise your holy name. We wonder again at who you are and what you have done. That you, Almighty God, should love the world you created so much that you gave us Jesus to be our Savior and Redeemer, so that we, who by nature sin against you, could receive forgiveness and become your very own pardoned people. We bow down and worship in adoration. Dear Heavenly Father, we confess once again our failure to live up to our calling. We admit that even in the face of such love, we all too often behave in a self-centered way, forgetting the needs of others. Forgive us. It is with thankfulness that we acknowledge your goodness and mercy in so many different ways. In a world where starvation is rife, we give thanks for our daily food. We ask a blessing on those gifts we've brought today for a local food bank. We thank you for our friends and family who look out for us when we need help and encourage us when we may be feeling both low and physically and spiritually. Help us to accept their kindness and concern for us, often expressed in a smile and a handshake, sometimes even a hug. As we conclude our prayers, O God, we use the words of a well-known song. God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Crown thine ancient church's story. Bring her bud to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom. Grant us courage for the facing of this hour. Amen.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You are living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
This morning's reading is from Luke chapter 1, beginning at verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were upright in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commandments and regulations blamelessly. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren, and they were both well on in years. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshippers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to give him the name John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well on in years." The angel answered, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their proper time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant, and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people."
Jesus. Amen. This time of Advent, we think of the coming of the King 2,000 years ago. But Father, we also think ahead to that time when he comes again in glory to rule and to reign. Lord, help us to keep our heads lifted high, to look out for that day. Father, we just pray a blessing on Steve now as he comes and brings your word to us. Lord, would you anoint him? Would you speak to us? Would you open our hearts and our ears, that we may hear you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
So I said, it's good to be here again. And I sense God's presence here already, even as Alistair prayed. It's good to gather together, isn't it? And it's good, last time I was here, you didn't have a pastor. Now you do have a good one. Hang on to him, support him, pray for him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the privilege of being able to be here. And as already prayed, when two or three showed up, you were already here, because we are your temples. We who believe in you, we are temples of your Holy Spirit. So when we came in, you came in with us. But we prayed that you, Holy Spirit, would come upon us. and accomplish what you desire in the Sunday school as well as here, for those at home unable to be here, for those that will listen later who maybe are traveling. Lord, we pray for your anointing, that, Lord, I would speak those words that are from your heart, and that each one would receive something specific and life-giving for them that then they can share with others. We thank you for this. Bless our brothers and sisters that are persecuted for their faith, those that are hiding away. Lord, be with them. May they know your presence, that they're not forgotten, Lord God. Bless them. May they know what you want to say to them today as well. And we thank you for this in that wonderful and powerful name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. In a sense, it was just another day for Zechariah the priest. He knew it was a great responsibility and privilege to be chosen to burn incense before God's presence. He had probably done it before, but was he really expecting anything? How often do we go through life the same way? We come to church on Sunday, attend special meetings, prayer meetings, share our faith with others, maybe hand out cards or texts. But do we really expect anything? We love God and want his will. We want something miraculous to happen. But sometimes everything just becomes a bit routine, doesn't it? Except this morning. Well, it certainly wasn't routine that day, was it? In the midst of the incense, the angel Gabriel shows up with a message from God. I doubt if he said, "Surprise!" But it certainly was for Zechariah, wasn't it? Especially the message Gabriel was about to give. From Genesis and all the way to Zechariah, God was dropping hints at what was to come. And our brother shared some of those already. God was dropping hints all the way from Genesis to Zechariah. Now through Gabriel, the Lord made it clear that dropping hints was over. Let me read some words that our brother just read from Luke 1. I know you've heard it many times before, but they're still as fresh as when they were written 2,000 years ago. One day Zechariah was serving God in the temple, for his order was on duty that week. As was a custom of the priest, he was chosen by lot to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and burn incense. While the incense was being burned, a great crowd stood outside praying. While Zechariah was in the sanctuary, an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing to the right of the incense altar. And that incense represented prayers unto God, wasn't it? Zechariah was shaken and overwhelmed with fear when he saw him. But the angel said, "Don't be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife Elizabeth will give you a son, and you are to name him John. You will have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drinks. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before his birth. And he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit and power of Elijah. He will prepare the spirit or the people for the coming of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children. And he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly." Zechariah said to the angel, "How can I be sure this will happen? I'm an old man now, and my wife also well along in years." Now, those of us that are elderly, I now am elderly, but it's hard to believe. I'm an old age pensioner. I didn't used to be. So those that are in my age group or older, you can appreciate what Zechariah was thinking when this angel told him this. Then the angel said, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the very presence of God. It was he who sent me to bring you this good news. But now, since you didn't believe me, What I said, you will be silent and unable to speak until the child is born, for my words will certainly be fulfilled at the proper time. When Zechariah's week of service in the temple was over, he returned home. Soon afterwards, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and went into seclusion for 5 months. How kind the Lord is, she exclaimed. He has taken away my disgrace of having no children. Imagine the joy that Zechariah and Elizabeth felt knowing that they would finally have a son, even in their old age. A miracle from God. Their shame of barrenness would be wiped away, because in those days it would be a terrible shame to have no children, especially not a son. But that shame would be wiped away. They could hardly believe it. In fact, Zechariah did have trouble believing Gabriel. Thus, he remained mute for 9 months. This joy and hope wasn't just for this aged couple, though, nor only for Israel. Gabriel was revealing hope far beyond anything they could have ever imagined. Their son John would not only become a mighty man of God, he was going to prepare the way for the way, the truth, and the life. He had prepared the way for the Messiah, the hope of the world. God was done dropping hints. It was time for the greatest gift of all to come. Proverbs 13:12 declares that hope deferred makes the heart sick, but a dream fulfilled is a tree of life. In Jeremiah 29, it declares, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope." Gabriel was declaring to Zechariah that a future and a hope was now here, that the dream would soon be fulfilled, not just for a long-desired son, but for a son who announced to the world the long-awaited answer to their prayers, Emmanuel, God with us. As we know, it happened exactly as Gabriel declared to Zechariah, and later as he declared to Mary. The Lord kept his word, and because those he spoke to obeyed, you and I benefit today, having the privilege of knowing the one who was promised. If you don't yet know Jesus and his forgiveness, then you can right now. You know, we always need to remind people, don't we? Sometimes there's people that sit in church for years and never make a commitment to Jesus. And if anyone is here that doesn't yet know him personally, now's the time to do it, isn't it? You know, we never know, do we? How many know how long we have? In April, I got a call from America that a brother had, or a sister had, died unexpectedly. And then a few days later, my brother, just older than I, died. So I went back to America for that. We don't know, do we? We don't know. And it's always important that we're ready. This is why John the Baptist came, wasn't it? So to declare the hope that we have, that we might be ready for when it's our time. He is right here by his Spirit, ready to bring us into right relationship with Father God. Now is the time of salvation, says the Lord. God gave the promise, but we have to do something about it, don't we? We can't earn our salvation because it's by faith in Jesus. But Zechariah had to do something all those years ago. He had the promise, but then he had to go out and do something, didn't he? First, he had to believe, and then to take action. Zechariah struggled to believe at first because he was looking at himself and his wife. They were way beyond childbearing age. God hadn't answered their many prayers for children before. Why should he do it now? Sometimes we don't have hope because we're looking at ourselves, aren't we? You're looking at our resources. We're looking at our ability We're looking at our bank account instead of looking at the infinite resources in God and the promises that he provides. Eventually, though, Zechariah did believe and moved, and God moved on his behalf. But then he had to take action. He had to do something about the promise. James writes that faith without action is dead. God has given mankind many promises. Promises for salvation, peace, hope, provision, and so much more for ourselves and for others. Those promises are true and powerful. But they're totally useless unless we do those two things. You know, there's lots of promises in here, isn't there? This is packed full of real promises by a real God who is able to do them. But they're just dead words without faith. We have to do something about it, don't we? Those two things. Believe what God says. Take the action God directs us to. Zechariah was promised a son that would prepare the way for the Lord, for Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior of the world. God makes it clear in his word that today you and I, who believe, have the same calling. Jesus told his disciples then, and you and me today, in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, I know you've heard this plenty of times. I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. The Apostle Paul reinforces this in 2 Corinthians 5. Because we understand our fearful responsibility to the Lord, we work hard to persuade others. If it seems we are crazy, it is to bring glory to God. And if we are in our right minds, it is for your benefit. Either way, Christ's love controls us. Since we believe that Christ died for all, we also believe that we have all died to our old life. He died for everyone so that those who receive his new life will no longer live for themselves. Instead, they will live for Christ who died and was raised for them. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a brand new person. The old is gone, a new life has begun. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to himself. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. And that's the message that John the Baptist spoke, wasn't it? For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. And this is what it's all about. This is what it's always been about, isn't it? It's why God sent Gabriel over 2,000 years ago to both Zechariah and to Mary. Through God's promise to that elderly man came hope to the world, hope for something far greater than anything he could have ever hoped or imagined. You and I have that same message. And that message hasn't changed. This hope, foretold so many years ago, prepared before the foundation of the world, is for you, me, and every man, woman, and child out there that don't yet know Jesus. Hope that God wants us to freely share with others. Hope because of the one that John the Baptist would prepare the way for, Jesus. If we believe, receive, and take action to share him with others, just as John the Baptist did, Others will rejoice just as Zechariah and Elizabeth did so many years ago. But we can't do it on our own, can we? We need the resources God gave John the Baptist, God's Word, and the Holy Spirit. John was filled with the Holy Spirit from birth, or before birth. We need him. We can't do it on our own. We need God's Word, and we need his Holy Spirit. We need the resources God gave John, and they're available. Then in faith, as we step out as the Lord directs us, even as Zechariah did, then God will provide hope to others through us. As we do, as God promises, others will come to faith as well. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. You do amazing things. You went and talked to that old man in the temple and gave him a promise he could hardly believe. In fact, he didn't believe it at first. But then he received. And you made the way for your son to come. Lord, we pray that you would do the same in us. You would speak a fresh word of hope to us. Some who maybe have given up, Lord God, and maybe given up on ourselves or given up on family members or neighbors or others that we've talked to and prayed for years. But Lord, you are a God of miracles. And we pray that you'd do it again in this fellowship and through this people, Lord God, through those that are listening, unable to be here today, that hope is still alive and powerful because of who you are, because of your Holy Spirit in us, because of your Word that is still living and active and sharper than a two-edged sword, able to bring life and to bring hope to others. So we pray that this Christmas season we would be the salt and light you've called us to be, to believe in who you are and what you've done and what you want to do, and then to take the action that you speak to us. And we pray for miracles, Lord, for new sons and daughters coming to faith, seeking to know more about you, wanting and hungry to become disciples, that then they could go out and share that message of hope with others. And we thank you in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. We'll finish with the song, Christ Our Hope in Life and Death.
Our hope in life and death, Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence that our souls to him belong? Who holds our days within his hand? What comes apart from his command? What will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah! Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah! Now and ever we can. Christ, our hope in life and death. What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is his grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise. stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. What will we sing? Christ, he lives, Christ, he lives, and what rewards will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him, there we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope.
Ever since I first heard of your strong faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for God's people everywhere, I have not stopped thanking God for you. Asking God, the glorious Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, to give you spiritual wisdom and insight so that you might grow in your knowledge of God. I pray that your hearts will be flooded with light so that you can understand the confident hope he has given to those he called his holy people, who are his rich and glorious inheritance. I also pray that you will understand the incredible greatness of God's power for us who believe in him. This is the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead and seated him in the place of honor at God's right hand in the heavenly realms. And may you, Lord, direct our steps into what you have for us, that we would not only live in hope, but we would share this wonderful hope with others in the power of your Holy Spirit and for your glory, Lord. And in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.